4:01, and I note the presence of a quorum today, so I will call this meeting of the Northampton Transportation and Parking Commission to order. This is June 21st, 2016. My name is Ryan O'Donnell. I'm the chair of the commission. Let me announce the audio and video recording of these august proceedings. And let's begin, as we always do, with introductions, going around, starting with our question.
Julie Sharp, I'm the board for city council.
Jasper, chief of police.
Nancy Forrestall, assistant city collector.
Donald Scalia, director of public works.
Christopher Nett, citizen.
Jamie Albert, Fisher, citizen.
Patty Chan, DPW.
Terry Ushko, DPW.
We'd like to welcome the new director of the Department of Public Works, Director Scalia, who's joining us. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Look forward to transportation parking issue related to work with you. We begin every meeting with public comment. And so at this time, I'd ask if there's anyone who'd like to give public comment on any issue. If you're further down on the agenda, to wait until that time to speak, or you can speak both times. Otherwise, feel free to come up and speak on any issue. The only thing you should know is that we don't engage in a back and forth during this time, because we're going to talk about an issue, we have to post it in advance on the agenda. But you're free to come up and provide information to the commission, and we can also follow up with you after the commission. So having said that, is there anyone who'd like to come and provide public comment?
Good afternoon. Thank you, Ryan. My name is Joe Squires, I'm 38 Lincoln Avenue. And I'm talking about truck traffic on Lincoln Avenue again. I bought my house on Lincoln Avenue close to 30 years ago, quiet residential street close to downtown. Lincoln Avenue now is a disaster. Truck traffic to the coke plant and industrial park is out of control. These trucks are now using our once quiet street as a main route to the coke plant. The city of Northampton granted Coca-Cola an expansion some 7 to 8 years ago. The residents of Lincoln Avenue should not have to put up with the volume of trucks that now go to the expanded coke plant. It is downright dirty, dusty, and noisy. The coke companies say they want to be good neighbors. I do not think they know the definition of a good neighbor. The residents of Lincoln Avenue have done all they can, meeting with coke officials, the police department, putting up our own signs, the list goes on and on. We had meetings with Mayor Narkowitz, former City Councilor Angel Plasman, former City Councilor Owen Freeman Daniels. Our present councilor and chairman of the board, Ryan O'Donnell, did not create this problem. He has been invited to a couple of meetings in our neighborhood, along with the police department, and no show. Last year, about 15 residents and children went before the city council to voice their concerns. There are about 20 young children living on our street. There's a disaster waiting to happen, hopefully not a tragedy. We were told by the city council to file a traffic calming report, which we did. The report came back showing about 150 trucks going through Lincoln Avenue in a two-week period. I would not wish this volume of truck traffic on anyone else's street. These trucks roll through our street 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. It is time, effective immediately, between the city and coke officials to bring this disaster to an end. We have been complaining about this for at least the past 7 years. That's a long time but no results. The road is turning into a mess. The trucks roll by as you're trying to eat your dinner on your deck. The house shakes and rattles in the middle of the night as you're trying to sleep. Until you have lived on Lincoln Avenue, you have no way to know what we go through on a daily basis. There are signs everywhere. They do not work, and there was little or no enforcement. In closing, this is a huge nightmare that we face every day. The city granted coke the expansion, and it's time for our elected officials, this committee, and management at the coke plant to fix this problem. Our patients are gone, and our quality of life has been ruined. We all pay our fair share of taxes, some more than others. We deserve a better quality of life. If anyone on this committee would like to talk to me, give me a call. We can meet at my house, sit on my deck, and try to talk as I roll on by. I was thinking the other day. This is the house I bought some 30 years ago, the house that I raised my daughters in, the house I call home, the street that I used to love, Is this where I really want to live, on the truck-infested streets? Thank you very much. Enjoy your summer.
Thank you. Other public comment?
I'm Michelle Squires. I've seen you before.
Welcome back.
I actually have a few different ideas. I'm going out there because I talked to a truck driver one day in the back of the Tusco Trucking, which is their lot is behind the old Amherst Woodworking. And I got their manager there. And he informed me of a few different things that he's not happy with Coca-Cola because of the lack of signs, and a lot of truck drivers come and they don't know where they're going because the bill's lading them and say Coke, they say organic beverage, and you know, the traffic out on the street gets backed up because of the way it's designed with their trailers going, tractor trailers going in, wanting to go in, and they stop them at the little hut there, and then the rest gets all backed up, and this guy's telling me how the residential people now cut through the parking lot to the left of PBTA, which is dirt, and a dirt block behind the old Amherst Woodworking, to go through Bradford?
Bates.
No. It's Bates, and cut around Woodlawn to get around town to avoid that. So he's been blocking it off. But anyway, he also informed me that flashing light up on the highway that the state put up about the height restriction, that the trucks don't follow because they don't go left. I mean, they still all, not all come left, but the majority of them. He told me that at night that they can't see that, that the light actually blinds them and they can't read that sign. And I'm like, that's good to know. That was quite interesting to me. And he also told me, which I found quite interesting, is down at Amazon in Windsor, Connecticut, at when you get off exit 38B, I went online and looked it up. And there's actually a sign there that says, Amazon deliveries, ignore GPS. Because our biggest problem, is that these drivers are following the GPSs because it's the shortest distance getting off that highway. And we know that because Coke has tried different things with changing their address and this and that, but it just, don't do it. So anyway, a few different things. I think our solution is, not that there's a good one, but we need to get together. I mean, somebody in the city government's got to have a name like Coca-Cola that we can sit down and talk with. I mean, it's got to come from there. Somehow between them and the GPS and their better signage, which I know that they're kind of, we're kind of limited on all that, but we just, we're not giving up. So you'll see. Thank you.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much.
Yeah, just an additional quick comment. My name is Lydia Rackman. I don't live on Lincoln. I live on Grant. And I hear trucks rolling by all the time too, day and night. And I just wanted to say that I don't think it's just about the GPS. I think it's a shortcut during traffic. Because when some efforts were made last year was it? I'm a dog walker, I'm on him constantly. And I noticed a drop off in the truck traffic. It was absolutely noticeable. And as soon as the traffic light went in with the new train service and the trucks and the car and the traffic is backing up on Damon Road regularly, boom, the trucks came back again. I mean, it was right up the same.
That's what I noticed.
It went in and gone down and then it just shot back up. You know, I don't want to stay Damon Road in traffic either. Fortunately, I don't have to. But so I think the issue, the enforcement issue, is really important. I think it's only partially that their GPSs are directing this way. And also, I never see them coming the other way down down Lincoln during the day.
They do.
Oh, I haven't. But at night, they come flying down, and it's a little bit clear the trucks when they're coming off the highway that have accidentally made the turn because they kind of stop. They look around, you know, it was an accident. And then there's the ones that it's completely clear, they're just like bombing. So I think that signage is really important, but I really think that enforcement and I'm sure truck drivers probably like talk to each other about the code. I think that, I know maybe it's been tried before, but I think that that issuing some tickets might not be a bad idea.
Yeah, because I don't know if any of them.
Yeah, I think it's a shortcut. I don't think it's an actual, which is my, basically my opinion.
I think they need to be fined, like you're supposed to be. I mean.
I just don't simply, I also.
I see the data.
What's that?
Do you have further comments?
Always.
Do you want to say something else?
No.
Seven years.
We're good.
That's my comment.
We're good.
Is there anyone else who'd like to provide public comment before we get started? Okay. Well, thank you very much, and we'll be talking about this, I'm sure, on Lincoln Avenue. So we'll launch into our agenda, and item 4A is approval of minutes for the previous meeting. Is there a motion to approve the minutes? It's May 17th, 2016. Okay, made and seconded. Any discussion on the minutes? If you weren't here, you should feel free to abstain, but you don't have to abstain if you trust the veracity of the minutes. So if there's not any other discussion, all in favor of the minutes? Opposed? Abstentions? Okay. Bicycle and pedestrian subcommittee updates.
We've had our complete streets pop up. I know some of you were there. Thanks very much to the police department for all the help you guys gave. Thank you for all the help from them. It was great success. We're moving on to the next step. We talked about it back in head meetings. We're buying a temporary park. It's basically like 8 feet wide by 12 feet long. And we're going to pluck it down to block off the access to Cracker Barrel Alley. So we test that probably for 5 months. And then probably a year later, move it across the street and block off, again, cover the size of it, block off one parking spot from City Hall or two parking spots. So we sort of think about, you know, sort of four time scales, the one day thing, which we did on Saturday, the sort of longer, you know, smaller area geographically, but longer time period of this piece. Thinking about, you know, it's take a few years to get there, but thinking about what's the right solution for all of Main Street that we can do with cans of paint. And then just a little bit of a process when we rebuild Main Street completely 10 years or 12 years from now, what's the solution for that? There was a lot of discussion on Saturday and a lot of excitement about the parklets itself, sort of reclaiming part of the street. There was a lot of interest, but a lot less clear consensus about the bike lane portion. There's more discussion about that. I think it reminded me of the bike lane, but it's more the bike lane requires losing a travel lane, whereas the parklet doesn't really require losing. I think part of it's the easiest, which is why we're moving forward with that. So that's basically the my committee has been working with also on the plan itself for Main Street, and a little bit more feedback on the overall plan itself. They're meeting again on August 2nd, so after August 2nd, I'll be working this.
Okay, thank you. Any questions? Okay, I stopped by the demonstration, and it seems very well attended. So I have interesting discussion going on. People were there to see the experiment. So, updates from the DPW.
So, paving contract 2016, the bid opening was on June 1st, and the low bidder was Palmer Paving Corporation. Work should start up within the next month or two. Updates will be on the DPW blog. For crack sealing, the crack sealing crew has been in town the past 2 weeks. They have some more. They're not here this. Traffic comment. We installed the speed hump on Florence Road and we collect data before it was installed and after it was installed. The data will be processed for that in the future. Let us know the results. The hump will be removed next week. So the next traffic calming application, I want to put down traffic counters for those. The next one is Catherine Street.
exclusions to the sidewalk inventory? Is it truly that every sidewalk is a pretty much? Excellent. Thank you very much. No other questions? Okay.
Right. Every separate work for planning?
Oh, of course.
So separate from my head. So there's two projects moving forward. One is the city is eligible for this state grant, complete streets money. The mayor's approved moving forward on Pleasant Street. So, you know, we did a design for Pleasant Street that was sort of traffic calming, improved sidewalks and bike infrastructure as part of a MassWorks grant application. We're now splitting that application up, and so we're doing about $400,000 of work as part of this complete streets grant from the state, and then we're going to apply for MassWorks for additional about $1 million for more work on Pleasant Street. We're trying to figure out how we separate that. So our engineers are working on that. Basically, it's a deadline for complete streets piece. So what goes first is not necessarily going to be so much the biggest need, as well we can move fastest on. And then one other thing is, we had a meeting in Leeds, maybe a year ago now, on some traffic calming money for there. So it's a little different for the overall traffic calming applications when we have a pool of money. So we got money from Zoe Life Care as part of their traffic mitigation, and we're hiring an engineer, an outside engineer, to look at where Leonard Street hits Route 9. Right now it's at a sort of an angle, and so we can make it more of a right angle. So at least we move from design.
Not
money to build it, but it's
like
the first step.
Great. Any questions about the update from the planning? No. Okay. All right. Any other departmental updates? All right. Discussion items. 8A is the possible addition of 15-minute space on Market Street near Bridge Street and Main Street. This was on the agenda last time, and I don't think we have a representative for many of the businesses who were interested in this last time. So this might be something that we delay to a future meeting and so we can actually bring an actual ordinance to establish such a space. So unless there's any objection, we'll continue this to another meeting. Okay, so we'll continue 8A. Now we come to 8B. This is crosswalk and general traffic issues near 126 West Street. And this was an issue brought to my attention by Carla Youngblood, who I see is here. From facilities management at Smith College, so I'd invite her to kind of make an introduction to this issue, and then welcome.
Thank you. Just a disclaimer, I'm here as a concerned resident, not as a Smith College representative. But our offices are, our facilities offices are at 126 West Street, and there's a crosswalk that connects us with the main campus. It also connects staff parking lot and the indoor track and tennis. The posted speed limit is 25. I don't believe anyone goes 25. The Northampton Police Department was kind enough recently to put up,
speed trailer.
Thank you, the speed trailer to clock. And we noticed a huge improvement, a lot of brake lights, but a huge improvement folks bringing down their speed, but of course it was temporary. My concern is, and I don't know if everyone knows where this is, but you're coming down West Street from Main, and you pass our parking garage, and then there's a curve that's very close to our crosswalk, so cars can be on you before they realize that someone's crossing. And then coming from the other direction, it's coming off 66. I'm not sure what that posted limit is, but I believe it's more than 25. So it's just a tough place for cars to realize they need to slow down. You know, it's one thing for the folks that work at facilities. We typically don't step out until cars are stopped. However, there was an accident maybe 1 month ago. Car stopped, but the one behind didn't. Hit the car in front, and this is just something that you would expect given the traffic patterns. My real concern is the number of students that use that crosswalk. They're not, you know, by right, the crosswalk is theirs to step into without giving much thought to whether a car is stopping or not. And I just want to prevent, you know, an accident where a pedestrian is hurt. So my request is to, I guess, would be to ask this commission to study that crosswalk and see what it might be eligible for traffic calming. You know, I don't know if that's a speed table, but something permanent to make that safer. And then my follow-up question would be, what are the steps this commission takes?
Okay.
So just background, I know you're in your individual hat, not the Smith hat,
right.
But maybe 4 years ago, the city, no DPW in planning, maybe police as well, participated in a traffic safety study that Smith arranged and paid for. And I was primarily looking at connections from bike path to Smith, but they looked at everything from Earl Street all the way up to West Street. And I know that came up in the piece. So I think there's already a study probably in a lot more detail than we do, although I don't know if I ever saw the final study. We, of course, hope that Smith would fund some of the improvements. So I don't know where that is.
Since my disclaimer.
Okay.
my disclaimer.
But it's, before we did anything, I want to see that study and see what it looks like.
Who did the study?
Smith paid for it. I don't remember the firm.
Oh, I see.
And I showed up for the, you know, they did a sort of 3-hour meeting, and I was there for that process, but I don't know what the final outcome was.
But it was commissioned by Smith. It wasn't the Pioneer Valley Planning Authority.
Correct. It was commissioned by Smith.
All right. Well, it might make sense to be in touch with Smith, I guess. Any other thoughts or questions? Well, I mean, it seems, you know, we certainly study crosswalks, you know, not all the time, but we're, you know, looking at the one in Hampton Avenue and others. But it does sound like it would be reasonable to try and track down the information that's already been gathered. And so that would be, I would agree that would make sense as a first step in this case.
Okay, I can put my hat back on.
I can
track, I'll do my best to, because I started 4 years ago, so it might have been right before I came on.
I have no track sense of time, so maybe it was 5 years ago.
Okay, yeah, and I'll try and track that down. And then would I then approach you, Wayne, or would I submit that to the committee?
You can do both. Or you can certainly be in touch with me since we are in touch.
That's yeah, just, so I can just email you if I find it.
That
okay.
Would be perfect.
But beyond that, say we don't find it, mm-hmm. What is the typical? Because I, from hearing the crosswalk on Hampton, there is a process for studying.
There's a traffic comp process. So when requests are made from residents for some kind of traffic calming, whether it's a speed table or even just line painting or whatever. There's a concern that there's speed. There's a process we go through. The first step is we kind of, it comes to us with a number of signatures to kind of clear a threshold amount of community support. Then it comes here, we debate it. If we vote to advance it, the DPW will do a study. You know, they'll put out the traffic counters and they'll measure speed. So we can make a decision based on some data. And then we go from there. If it's warranted to do more, then we discuss how to do more. But that's the process. I mean, this situation wouldn't necessarily follow that process. It's not really in a residential neighborhood. It's kind of in a, it's in the Smith, you know, on a major road near Smith College. So I would just say we should bring it back to a future meeting and discuss how we would evaluate it if we can't find information that's all of it is pre-existing.
So. Okay. Thanks.
Is that okay? All right. Thank you. Thanks to both of your hats. For...
Yeah, you're welcome.
All right. Now we have C is the sidewalk on Barrett Street and issues related to bus service. I guess there's Mr. Douglas Ross here today. I don't see, and this was put on the agenda at his request and also the request of Councilor Carney, but I don't see the person who requested it, so unless there's any objection, we will move on from that one. Item D is traffic issues near the crosswalk on Pine Street and Corticelli Street. And we have Elizabeth here, am I guessing? Okay. Well, Elizabeth, would you care to introduce
sure.
us
thank
since
you so
contacted
much.
Me with this issue?
I'm sorry, I have surgery for both of my ears. I hear all right, but if it's still, I couldn't hear you at all. As a matter of fact, if I speak a little loud, please forgive me for this.
You're perfect.
All right, thank you. My name is Elizabeth Dipka. I'm the owner of River Valley Rest Home on 159 Pine Street. It's a level 4 facility licensed for the state of Massachusetts, 25 beds. And I'm here to ask you kindly, I'm not going to ask too much of you, but I needed to take it very serious. And for we spoke on the phone, I spoke on the phone with you, and I appreciate your kind, though. A lot of time I tell people I didn't fall to River Valley yesterday. I'm in this business for 36 years. 32 years in Sacramento, California, and 4 years here. It's a completely different animal here, in this part of the country. I don't know, it's more slow, I should say, and it's different. Let's put it that way and leave it that way. As you probably heard, probably you read in the paper that one of our residents was hit by a car. I'm pretty emotional because I like what I'm doing. I do it for so long, and probably you're from the police department, you know River Valley for sure. Because when we took over, we had different kind of people over there. Very, very different. There are fist fights and so on and so forth. But right now, we have a very nice group of people. This particular gentleman was hit by a car. He was there in the facility for 27 years. Nice and quiet. Probably, if you live in Florence, you might saw him because he was walking everywhere and he couldn't stand the noise of the car and he would cover his ears here and there. Very skinny guy. And that evening, it was a husband and a wife and a daughter in a car, and he could see right at the corner of Corticelli and Pine Street. He was coming from Sam's convenience store. They go there all the time to buy Coca-Cola or whatever, and they didn't see him. So the gentleman was driving a truck. The police department has the report. I went and I took the report, and he hit him a week and a half after that he died, unfortunately. I was supposed to be here the last meeting when I spoke with you, I guess if I'm not, sorry if I do this. I was about to come, but then I got a call from the sister. Sister is almost 90 years old, and she's telling me, don't even get involved. Don't go there and tell them what happened, because I'm planning to sue a lot of places. And I said, I am in this business for a very long time. I've never been sued, not even once. I never sued anybody. Don't think that I'm an angel falling from heaven now, because I'm not. But I love the people, and I was raised by my father of 10 children that we were. And I take life very, very serious. Very serious. So I said, I'm not gonna get involved. I'm not here to tell you what happened. And I'm not gonna discuss that whatsoever, because I don't want it to testify in court and stuff like that regarding the woman telling me not to come here. But I am very concerned about the other residents we have right now. In December last year, there was another gentleman that was hit. You have the report to the police department. I think he had 4 ribs broken, a hip and a shoulder. He is not with us anymore. Before we took over, I heard there was another gentleman that was killed. Someone was killed in the same area. So I'm not sure. Now, Joe was also not killed on the spot, but he died after all because of the whatever he, I'm not gonna talk about that, as I said. So what we did when I took over, and I'm very firm. I love these people, but I'm very firm with them. And I told them over and over and over again. But they were like children, because these people are recovering from drugs, from family abuse, from alcohol, from, they have psychiatric problems. You can tell them, and here goes. So I tell them over and over again, you don't have job. All day go and go to Sam, go downtown, go wherever you want, guys. When the seat's dark, don't go out. And what I did, I bought them reflective vests. I put them by the door there, and I put a vest on. I bought them flashlights. I said, take that flashlight. I told them not to go in the dark, stay inside in the dark. Some of them they do, some of them they don't. So what I ask you, kindly, please, I saw on, when I spoke with you on the phone, I saw on Ryan and Florence show, you guys put a wonderful bump there. And when I spoke with you on the phone, you said that was for the purpose of people slowing down. Well, that's what I want. I want them, you guys to come and put a bumper, a wonderful bumper. As a matter of fact, yeah, we live in a year of technology. Wonderful bumper, not the one that's like that. It's a wonderful bumper. I want you exactly for this purpose, to put it there that they can see that's a crosswalk.
Okay.
Please do it. Okay. And I need it from you. Since I see your banners, because I spoke on the phone with you everywhere, I want to see this
slow
stop.
Traffic, actually.
Stop. As soon as possible. Please.
Okay. Well, thank you very much. I appreciate you coming and provide this information to us. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Okay. So I'd like to open it up for discussion. I think everyone knows what crosswalk we're talking about, right? Is there anyone with initial thoughts before
I did run the information, and we have had 4 accidents there in the last 5 years at that crosswalk. 2 of those folks have passed away related to injuries incurred. And I think it's folks who are from the rest home who are crossing there. It's marked, it's well lit, but just because of the nature of where it is, I think it's kind of unexpected coming around the corner. So certainly, maybe 50% of the time, it's been a fatal accident. So certainly, we have our concerns about it from a police perspective.
Okay. Anyone else? As Alta does their survey of crosswalks, is this, I assume this is among those they're looking at?
Yeah, it's not doing any of them incredible depth. That would be more sort of what our unifying theme to look at. So I can ask them to look at it.
But okay. I'm moving up on this. We have a consultant.
I can follow what she said.
Sorry. I'll explain. We have a consultant that is looking at a number of issues in the city, and among those are crosswalks. And so we're trying to determine if they might have some other information to give us about this crosswalk. Councilor.
Is there a better, more visible place nearby for the crosswalk than where it is, if it's near a corner?
You look at moving it further down Pine Street, potentially, that would go over to Sands. That could be one possibility to explore that wouldn't be as close to the corner, because right now you come around the corner and you're kind of surprised by it. So that could be one option, is looking at just moving it down. But we would have to consider, then you've got people pulling out of that plaza, which could be a problem as well. So we would have to take a look and see where it would be most appropriate.
You have any idea how long it's going to take all of this consultation and all of the, because like I said, I want it before something else is happening. We cannot stop these people to tell them, because they are allowed to go anytime they want. The rule and regulation reads like that. I cannot tell them, and as a matter of fact, you cannot argue with them either. If you're not in this business for so long, and a minute you jump up. But because I know these people very well, I tell them over and over again, and they could go tomorrow or tonight, and they can be hurt. So if you have any idea how long it's gonna take all of this consultation to really do something about this.
Well, let me ask you a question in response to your question. If there were no crosswalk there, are people still going to cross at that location? Is it just a convenient place? Or if the crosswalk were moved, would they go down to where the new location of the crosswalk was to use it? Or are they going to continue to cross at the place?
They will. They will continue to cross the way they did for years and years.
Okay. Is there an opinion from our traffic engineer about possible ways of studying this, information we could gather, options we could weigh to maybe moving the crosswalk?
Put up the newest NCTV signs, because I've noticed driving by the signage there for that crosswalk. So that's an option. And we have someone painting all the crosswalks throughout the city annually, so we could look at
what's the newest sign logo you just said?
The newest signage from NCTV. It's like refresh reflective, so you can see it in the dark.
Just like a crosswalk sign.
It's, yeah, a crosswalk sign.
Is it just the pedestrian, the arrow is pointing to?
Because currently there's no signage at the crosswalk. There's one that's like a little ways down, it says 100 feet.
Okay.
But not at the crosswalk.
Can we put a paddle there, like the ones that are downtown, just for the time being? You know, the ones that are right in the middle of the road.
That's on Brian. That's the wonderful thing. They all come slow, and then they realize, okay, oh, here's a crosser. We have to slow down. Because I appreciate you guys. You came and you put those posts there. And I saw that with my own eyes. One guy came and threw it right like that. But they don't care.
Okay. All right, so this relates to your question about time, but there's sort of immediate, intermediate, and long-term things we can do. The very short-term thing is we can put the paddle in the middle of the road, in the middle of the crosswalk, so it's more visible and warns people to slow down and stop. And the police department will do that, so thank you.
And I wanted to extend my thank you very much for the wonderful job you do as a police. I appreciate that. I really, really do. Thank you so much.
And before we repaint the crosswalk, I would like to, if we could do an analysis maybe of whether it would make sense to move the crosswalk. And is that something we could ask the DPW to do in concert with the police department perhaps? Would you be willing to look at that and maybe bring that to the next meeting?
We will.
Okay, thank you very much. All right. And
is there anything that I can have it in writing from you, whatever action you're going to take?
If you wish, I can send you an email. I mean, everything we're saying now is public record and is being recorded on video, so it's definitely, but if it's helpful to you, I can send you an email.
I really do appreciate that very, very much.
And then based on that, we'll decide what the more long-term thing we can do is, you know, if we have a new crosswalk location, we'll paint it there, and then we'll put signage there, I would assume.
I thank you so very much, okay. And I hope I didn't ask too much of you guys.
Not at all. We appreciate your time.
Thank you so very much. Have a wonderful afternoon.
Same to you.
Thank you.
Item E is, and we're going to go to item E, but quickly, I just noticed that this is, the printout is a version of the agenda that is slightly out of date. After this agenda was posted, a revision was posted, and I don't know if we have printouts of that one.
No, okay. I didn't see that one.
All right, but online and duly posted, we also have the PBTA on the agenda for discussion of the Academy Music Crosswalks. We will get to you, but I just realized we're looking at the wrong agenda. Although we did post the correct one online, so we're okay with the open meetings one. But moving right along to E, when we'll do the PBTA right after this, E is issues in city regulations relative to taxis, livery vehicles, ride sharing, such as Uber, etc. And we have Don Lynch from Mercedes Cab. So Don, welcome back.
Hello. So I have a prepared statement that is much like the one you heard last month, which I'll read. There's a couple of new things in the end. My name is Don Lynch, and I live at 37 O'Connor Avenue in Holyoke. I'm an operations manager for Mercedes Cab. Here in Northampton, we own Go Green and Funky Cab, and we do business at 376 East Hampton Road. You probably know it best as Ernie's Towing. The primary issue of the regulations is that they don't allow for the use of livery cars by a properly licensed company. There are over 40 companies operating livery cars in our area, but because we have an office within the city limits, under the current regulations, we're prohibited from doing so. It's common knowledge that we do use liveries, and as soon as regulations exist, we'll be in full compliance. But the bottom line is 99% of our business legally does not require the use of taxi plates. We'd rather use liveries because they cost less to insure, and because of that, allowing livery plates would actually increase public safety because it's easier for a company to get higher liability coverage at a lower price for a livery car than it is for a taxi-plated vehicle. Another issue with the regulations is that they do not address ride-sharing services or transportation network companies, TNCs for short, and that would be things that you bring with. With 17,000 users and 1,000 drivers in our area as of February of this year, it's very clear that Uber is here to stay, and it's unacceptable that they're not subject to the same oversight as other vehicles for hire. Springfield and Braintree have both already begun working on legislation to regulate DNCs, and the state will be updating its regulations to cover them by the end of the year as well. As Christian Rogers wrote in his 2015 essay, The Social Cost of Uber, quote, "It seems unquestionable that Uber aims to undermine traditional taxi service, and it seems manifestly unfair that taxi drivers and Uber drivers can operate in the same market subject to different rules." There are other issues with the regulations, most notably the contradictions, such as the requirement that taxis solicit from taxi stands that do not exist. But the bottom line is they're painfully out of date, and they fail to meet the needs of an industry that is changing rapidly. Furthermore, the existing regulations would only serve to drive businesses like ours out of the city, worthy to be enforced as they're written. In addition to allowing livery cars and placing restrictions on TNCs, we also suggest that taxi stands are reinstated in the downtown area and that livery staging areas be created for livery cars to park while they're awaiting their next scheduled trip. And this is going to also increase public safety, improve traffic flow, and free up parking spaces downtown. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you. Questions for Ms. Lynch to get started? What is the difference between a delivery vehicle and a taxi?
I need to ask that. Okay, so basically, it has a different type of plate. Obviously, the registration, the insurance, all of the sort of back-end stuff is different. But out on the street, it basically means, the easiest way to describe it, if you've been to New York City, is a taxi plate is like the yellow cab, and a livery is like the Lincoln Town Cars. So you have to actually call to get a livery car. And that, according to the state of Massachusetts, is essentially the only difference. A livery has to be requested via your office, your dispatch, and that can be through the phone or through a computer, like a smartphone. And then a taxi plate is permitted to pick up fares off the street. So like you could flag them down and hop right in, whereas you can't technically do that in a livery. Certain companies do that anyways. We try not to, that's not really what we're about. We're looking for regulations to abide by. There just aren't any.
Okay. The state legislation, could you give us an update about where that actually stands? Do you expect it to pass? Would it preempt the need for us to do anything?
That's a good question. I think what it comes down to is like, are the regulations going to ever be enforced? Because as they are written, liveries are forbidden. You can't actually operate them if your office is here in Northampton. So, I mean, at any point, you know, the chief could walk into my office tomorrow and hand me a cease and desist for all of those cars. You know, that being said, the city is aware that they're there. They know we're using them. It's been discussed with the city clerk. And, you know, everyone's just kind of aware that these regulations aren't, I mean, you couldn't enforce them. You'd run all the companies out.
Okay. But the state legislation has to do with the ride sharing.
Right, exactly.
What does it have to do with liveries?
Well, that's pending. It's sort of tied in because the ride sharing, the Uber card, well, they're passenger plates, but they're sort of going about it as like a livery service kind of a thing. The passenger plate issue is a whole other thing, a safety issue, obviously, but the legislation is pending at this point, and the state has essentially been ordered to create some guidelines, some restrictions, some sort of oversight. If the state fails to do so by September 30th, from what I've read, then the Uber service will be subject to the same regulations as taxis. However, I don't think they're going to let that happen because it would just be a disaster. So I think that's forcing them to kind of come up with something to regulate it. But as far as what they're going to do, I'm not really sure.
Okay. And what about Springfield and Braintree? I mean, you say they're beginning a process.
Yeah, and now they're pending the state legislation as well. It's all been put on hold pending this whole issue with the state. And so, you know, each municipality, every town and city can run taxis and liveries how they see fit. And what I've been told by some city officials is, well, it doesn't matter that your liveries are legal at the state level because we don't allow them in Northampton. Yet, as I said, there's over 40 companies that are picking up in liveries within the city. So you're saying I can't just because my office is in the city? You know, that seems crazy. So like I said, if the regulations were rewritten so that, you know, made a little more sense, because it seems clear that the city doesn't mind liveries.
Right.
They just need to kind of reword.
Okay. And do you know the genesis of why liveries are not allowed?
I do. It's somewhat anecdotal.
Okay.
Although I suppose it is part of the public record. I came up at a city council meeting, and Bill Dwight was talking about.
We trust what he says.
I know, right? He actually remembers, I believe, when this happened.
Okay.
I'd like to maintain a level of professionalism, and I won't name any names, but there's a particular transportation company in the area that is not really favored by anybody. And from what I was told and sort of gleaned from that conversation, the regulations were put in place to kind of prevent them from doing business in the city. Because they had a tendency to run a fleet of liveries with no licensing kind of before it was cool to do so.
So it's not based on any policy?
Correct.
Rationale?
Not that I'm aware of.
Not that you're aware. And does any other community in the area have a similar prohibition?
No. Nope. In fact, every community allows for livery vehicles. They just have, you know, a set of regulations governing each one. I mean, we'd like to see the restrictions sort of less separate. I mean, the industry, as I said, is changing so rapidly, and some of the differentiation between the two types of vehicles, it's just not necessary. And like I said, 99% of the business legally is a livery type of service. So, I mean, in an area like ours, that it's not a super urban like a Springfield or a Boston, or, you know, you don't need taxi plates. Nobody's hailing cabs. Even when the bars let out, they're not hailing cabs. You know what I mean? They're hopping on the bus, or they're walking, or they're getting in their car, unfortunately. But, and I think it remains to be seen what happens if we do put those taxi stands in, because our company's based in Provincetown, and we did work with Provincetown and installed, I think, 6 new taxi stands. And that's when I was just a driver. I was a full-time driver out there. And I noticed immediately that once people got used to the cab stand being there, that they would go there and wait there for the next cab to arrive to pick them up. So that again creates another public safety element. I mean, think about 2 a.m. on a Saturday night and those crowds of people waiting for their rides if they had a place to go where they knew a car would be by to scoop them up in a moment. You know, it's the sort of bigger picture of how the transportation industry is functioning in the city as a whole, I think.
Well, and Amherst has them, doesn't it?
What's that?
Amherst has taxi stands.
Yes, they do. Amherst is an interesting case. I've watched the Amherst taxi industry change day and night in the last probably year. I mean, really quickly. Uber had a lot to do with it, but also the increase in the PBTA service. Those kids, they're very fickle. There's no loyalty. So they really go with Uber, you know, over a regular cab company. And most of the companies that were licensed out in Amherst are gone now, or they've dropped. Aaron's had 14 cars, I believe, licensed in Amherst 2 years ago, and they might have one or two now. So it's really, you know, changing. And again, the taxi business is what's gone. These kids are all calling or putting in through the app for their rides. They don't, you know.
Okay. Are there any other questions from this lecture from the commission?
Is there a difference in background checks for drivers between livery and taxi?
That all depends on the regulations that are in place. So for example, with Uber, for a while the problem was that they weren't doing any type of background checks. I think that they might do a very basic query now. Our company, we run background checks on all of our drivers, taxi or livery, and get them licensed with the city. But as far as the liveries go, it's not required until you tell us it is. So that's kind of what I mean by, like, give us some rules to follow, because we could put anybody in that livery right now and send it out there. There's
you don't need a taxi license to drive a livery vehicle. So the taxi
correct.
And the taxi licenses issued by us and through
right.
the clerk's office. So when we get those, we look at them differently. I mean, we look at them versus a livery driver can have a different license. It's
right.
not looked at by the police at all. So it is, and that is one of our concerns with this, and I agree with most of what you say. Our ordinances are extremely antiquated. I think cell phones have changed a lot where people are calling now. They don't need a taxi stand. So the whole taxi, and that's the taxi plate typically goes with a taxi stand, which we don't have. But that is one of our main concerns is licensing. And, you know, I want to know that if we're having these vehicles out there, that we check through those drivers.
Right.
So certainly any sort of city ordinance that we would explore, we would want to involve a component where we're still looking at drivers so that we're sure we'll let the people in the vehicles that are safe.
Right.
And the other major component is insurance as well. We want to make sure that the passengers that are in those vehicles are protected. So that's one of the benefits of the taxi plate is that it requires all these other things. Not to say we couldn't put those in place with a livery,
right, exactly.
but it's certainly something that we would totally need to redo our existing ordinance, which
yes.
I think is actually appropriate. If not, you're probably going to go out of business. And over time, I mean,
if he chose to, and yeah, I mean, like I said,
we could
walk in
the,
tomorrow and
right.
say you're done, and we would have one cab out okay. of our seven because we have six liveries and one taxi plate. I mean, we could fix it pretty quickly. I would just put in a bunch of taxi applications the next morning, but it would certainly ruin our day and our week. And it's not something we're trying, you know, to make happen. We've asked repeatedly. We did have a fleet of all taxis at first because we didn't want to be going against any regulations, but essentially we were told that they're not going to be enforced, so there's not much to worry about.
And I believe we still have meter written into our, and you don't do metering, right? You do zone?
Well, the metering is required in the regulations,
mm-hmm.
but when you actually go to the city clerk to apply, you're told that you're not allowed to use meters and that you have to set up a flat rate. So again, with the contradictions,
right.
it's a little bit like mind spinning, and it took some time. Since you brought that up, I did want to mention, I've talked to John Fry, the meter inspector, like the weights and measures guy, and he takes issue with the maximum rates that are set. He said that the city has no business basically setting any kind of maximums. So I would like to see some sort of revision in the rates within the taxi code as well, whether that is enforcing the meter requirement without the restriction or, you know, something, just something really is all we're looking for.
Okay. Any other general questions or comments? The way we can go right now is, you know, if someone can cobble together a recommendation verbally, we could do that, so feel free, but I think it might make more sense to, if there's interest either among all of us or as individuals, to kind of discuss this within the limits of open meeting law, of course, and then return with perhaps a revision on issues of licensing and
I think looking at other municipalities in the area is a really good way, you know, to get an idea of where you want to go with this, because every other major area has an allowance for liveries, and they have either separate licensing or you have to get like a vehicle for hire license, and then you can either do the taxi or livery, and they have their separate, you know, requirements for each one. But you know, for example, Greenfield, I think they just updated their regulations like a couple of years ago. Amherst was in the last couple of years, so you know, we're behind the times, and I think we all know Northampton is much more hip than that, and we need to kind of catch up, right?
Powerful closing argument. One question for you, though, is, I hope you don't mind my asking, but there are other taxi companies in Northampton. I refresh my memory.
Well,
about
there's only one other one, actually, if you want to talk about licensed companies in the city, and that would be Cosmic Cab. To my knowledge, they don't have any livery plates at this time. I'm not sure.
That's fine. Here's why I bring it up is, if we do have a specific piece of legislation,
mm-hmm.
I want to make sure that it's developed in the open and that
right.
other companies are allowed to.
Oh, of course,
but
yeah.
I appreciate you bringing this, so.
And actually,
cool.
I mean, I know Jeff Miller, the owner of Cosmic,
okay.
and I was thinking it would be good to reach out to him anyway, so I'll probably just go ahead and do that.
All right.
And see if he doesn't generally show too much interest in this type of
regulatory type stuff, but I can see, okay. You know, he wants to get on board.
Tell him how fun it is.
Exactly. I'm having a blast with you guys right now.
No, it was a very good conversation. It was educational, and I think maybe we'll leave it there for today. Okay. And we can follow up in more specific, focused way.
Okay, perfect. And I've written a lot of letters to the city, but I can be reached at dawn@mercedescab.com if any of you want to follow up in any way. We're really excited to be a part of getting these regulations up to date. We think it's really important, and we'll do a lot of good things for the city.
Thank you very much, Dawn.
Thank you.
All right. Well, let's move to the PBTA, or visitors have been waiting patiently. And this is an issue we talked about at our March meeting.
Yes, March.
So,
you have a hand up for a
moment. Oh, yeah, that, thank you. Perfect. Yeah.
Some questions from the committee last time that we have looked into since the March meeting, and we do appreciate you giving us this time today to talk about them. So one of the big questions that was asked is, you know, is there a priority between the Academy Music bus stop or the Man Masonic? You know, what is PBTA's largest concern? And our largest concern is really the Man Masonic stop. It is a safety concern for us. It was relocated, I know I'm rehashing some history here, but it was relocated 4 years ago, 5 years ago, 2011, from being at the intersection of Main Street Masonic, now closer to the State Street New South Street side. So everything's double-sided in this handout. So if you look at attachment one, so we're looking on the north side of that bus stop and the four cars behind it. And pretty much what we are requesting to do is take where our current bus stop is and swap it with where the two cars are on the eastern side, so in front of Crazy Noodles in that location, close to Masonic Street side. With the 25 feet and then the 40 feet of those two cars, we'd have plenty of space to be able to pull the vehicle in safely, and we remove our 40-foot fixed group bus or 16-foot fixed group bus out of a right turn only lane, and we would no longer be lighting and boarding passengers basically on the road. So right now there's really no space for us to get over, and then once we are in that right turn lane, we're having issues getting back in the left turn lane to continue up to Smith College. So really this is an issue of safety for the PBTA, and an issue of pedestrian safety once they're off the bus as well, and then the ability to compare community as well, making sure they're well served. That before this move was made in 2011, we really had no issues with where the stop was. We do understand and appreciate being a 24-member community, parking is a premium. But at the same point in time, I believe we really appreciate the fact that we have to be very concerned about the safety of our customers and the residents of Northampton as well, the visitors. So pretty much our request is to use those two spots. There was a couple of questions from the commissioners here, basically asking if we could use a three spots in front of Viva Pasta instead. The issue we're seeing there is we'd be parking right in front of a crosswalk, creating some visibility issues. The right turn movement of traffic from Main Street onto Masonic Street, there'd be some conflicts there. Then any type of left turn or right turn movement is also be a conflict. So really don't think that's a starter there. And then talking about maybe eliminating two of the spots in front of Mama Iguana's or Ode. And while we appreciate and support that, we do feel as though if we were to have those two parking spots where the cars are and swap it with the bus stop, we believe we will be accommodated.
Okay, excellent. So on that subject, that first part, any questions or discussion? All right, now why was it moved in 2011? Just as an experiment to sort of see if you
can. I was not with the PBTA at that time,
okay.
So I cannot answer why it was moved at that time.
Okay.
But in terms of the impact we've had over the last 5 years, we've had a few accidents at that intersection, vehicle on other vehicles, so that was not what we want to continue to do.
Okay. That makes sense to me.
Maybe you said this last time, sorry, but maybe someone else, but If we move the buses back, do we get, I know we need to keep at least one spot for the right turn lane, but do we get a, is there room to put one parking spot back where the buses currently?
I believe there'd be space for a parking spot in that area. That's how the setup was before 2011, from my understanding.
There's two or just one?
I think there was two of that. Yeah. Could be.
There were two originally that were relocated to the start of the block.
Okay.
Other questions? All right. Should we move on to the other side of the street?
Oh, sure. Absolutely. So we had a lot of questions about this side. This is the Academy of Music, the new Pulaski Park with our new bus shelter and all the amenities coming in there. We have 750 passengers per day using that area. So one of the concerns that we had heard from the committee here is about taking that spot and putting the bus into that parking spot as a total. There's only 13 feet of space, if you refer to attachment one, from the crosswalk to the front of where that parking spot is. And so some of the concern was, well, if you put a bus up there with the height of the bus, is there gonna be some visual impacts? So upon hearing that, we did refer to some other transit authorities, setback and dimensional requirements. Most of them were saying it would have to be 10 feet back from a crosswalk, some said 25. But overall, we are seeing that the average is about 20 feet setback from a crosswalk. So if we flip to attachment four, you're gonna see basically the impact of how the bus would look with an approaching vehicle towards that crosswalk. So on the left-hand side, you see the current setup with a 13 feet, and then with the bus being a 13 feet. And using that, you can see how that would have some type of negative impact if there was not more of a sight distance. So if you flip over to the next page, you can then see the 20-foot setback from the bus. And that does provide a vehicle from 140 feet away to be able to see somebody entering the crosswalk, traveling at a greater speed. So we believe by setting that bus back 20 feet from the crosswalk would give us an additional 14 feet of space, accommodating more of our X98, which does operate there, the small shuttle van. So that provides more space to park for all the buses. Not all of us at peak time, but more buses at that time. And then lastly,
can I ask you a question about that?
Of course.
I think I understand conceptually what you're talking about, mm-hmm. but I'm trying to, maybe I'm looking at the wrong picture.
Oh, sure.
So you're saying if there's a bus there instead of a car, the sight line is disrupted, so the bus is now in the sight line, that's what the yellow dash lines are.
Correct.
Is that what it is?
Correct.
All right, so you would propose moving the whole thing back, the bus stop, the whole stretch, 20 feet, that's what you're saying.
What I'm asking for is instead of the bus being 13 feet back where the existing parking space is, to make it sure that's 20 feet back from the existing crosswalk.
And does that push back the other end of the bus stop? That pushes that back 7 feet, I guess.
It would give us an additional 14 feet of space. So if we refer back to attachment one here, so right now the car is 13 feet back.
Right.
If we were to eliminate that car and say 20 feet, we're gaining, it's actually the spot's 21 feet, it would give us 14 feet of additional space there.
I got it. So you're not taking the whole parking space anymore.
We would be taking the majority of the parking space. There would not be a parking space.
Well, there
space
wouldn't be a parking space, but
right.
You're only
taking part of it, not the whole
right.
thing.
Okay.
And we also do have a, sorry, I got flipped around here. We also have a visual diagram of what it looks like with an individual on it as well. That's in your packet. It's right behind the oncoming car, 65 feet away. It's right on the other side of your packet there, counselor. You flip that one over. Yep. So basically showing what it would look like with the 34 feet, with the vehicle, no parked car, 13 foot setback with a 20 foot, and you can see more so coming forward if that had the 20 feet of space.
Okay. Thank you, this is very helpful.
Why is it that you need the extra space again?
We have, like I said, 750 passengers a day. At some points in time, we have up to 225 feet of bus coming into the area. That's only two or three times a day. But when that occurs, we are backed up onto New South Street. So basically, we're blocking traffic on New South Street trying to turn right as we're boarding and alighting people in the downtown area. So having this additional space will allow us to pull in our X98, which is the shorter shuttle bus, along with our other vehicles onto that stretch of bus stop area.
So three times a day you would use this space?
No, that's, we use this space.
Okay, would you have
but the extra space, I mean.
The extra space would be used almost every single, I mean, on the hour, at least on the half hour. From 7 a.m. to 7, 8 p.m.
So
you're
pulling all the way up.
Would the extra space eliminate the backup on the other street?
No. We would need 225 feet, so we'd be asking for a whole lot more parking spaces.
You're still going to have backup.
So you're pulling everything all the way up to this new stop. Mm-hmm. You want to create room in the back. Okay.
But you'll still have backup down the street. So what's the, just why bother then? If you're, if we're not helping, if we're not alleviating the backup problem, I see you get an extra feet, but
because for the majority of the time, it does help us make sure we can get our X98 vehicle onto that area.
That's a shorter one?
That's a shorter one. So we can get that vehicle and other 40-foot and 60-foot buses into the area. There still have those two or three peak times a day where that can occur. I think that's going to be a much larger conversation to solve that particular issue.
But the X98, the crosstown bus, mm-hmm. that only comes three times a day?
No. That one comes every hour to downtown. The 225 feet of bus, when we have the 43, the 40, the 39, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, that only happens three times a day.
Oh, I see. Okay.
I have some pictures that could I pass around also?
Uh-oh. Painting pictures.
Yeah. I went out and took some pictures of that area. Unfortunately, my pictures aren't quality, but we'll do that with me. I think it helps to show, particularly.
Thank you so much.
I think it kind of helps to show how what the situation is there and how close a front bumper of a car would be on top. I mean, that's just a car or a truck actually that's in that front parking spot in that first picture and how close that is to the parking lot, to the pedestrian crosswalk. I'm just really worried if you're looking at pictures of where the bus is, the bus 7604 that's shown there, that's right now back behind that existing parking spot. And you can see how a person stepping out would still be almost invisible until they're out committed to the passing traffic. And the traffic can get very congested in that area. We all know that. But that bus 7604 is nowhere near that crosswalk as it's parked already, let alone allowing those buses to move forward. You can see how much of a blind step out that is. And that is a major crosswalk that is going to get far, far busier because of the improvements to Pulaski Park. We're inviting people to come to Pulaski Park. And I think that it would be really dangerous to move the buses forward to that crosswalk. I realize that you're suggesting to keep them back X number of feet, but any large vehicle parked approaching a crosswalk, to me, is a very dangerous situation. Just as you're saying, across the street on the other side, you would not want to put your buses in front of the crosswalk because it's dangerous. it's no less dangerous on this side.
I would like to point out that the pictures that you're seeing is the oncoming from 65 feet. That is more reflective of your photo on the top section here that does show the crosswalk in full. I do understand your concern from the bottom shot here, where it's kind of from taken from behind the vehicle, but I think the perspective shown in this upper right photo is much more indicative of what the passenger vehicle will be seeing than the picture down this side, because we would have that sight distance. But I understand your concerns.
This first photo, this would be 13 feet.
The very first photo is, you can see where the truck is parked there.
Right. That's 13 feet right there.
That's 13 feet. And as you can see, what the picture of the 7604 bus and on the last pictures there, see the foot? That's that person walking back across. I mean, that's what you would see from somebody stepping out into that crosswalk. If you're looking at this picture where the truck is and all that sort of stuff, and you can see somebody just walking in front of the bus, turn that around and have that person stepping out from behind that bus.
And how many feet back is that bus?
That bus is behind that crosswalk.
So,
excuse me, behind that parking spot.
So more than 13. But
it's, how big is that parking spot? It would be 13 feet back to where the parking spot begins, and then this bus is back behind that parking spot.
Another 20 feet.
Well, I guess, so according to this diagram, maybe 34 feet total, yeah.
Any other questions or discussion?
Just because I have to do all my due diligence here. But I think the only part of this is also looking at the fire hydrant. I think right now it's about 5 feet away from the crosswalk, and then it's the parking space is 8 feet away. I think the city ordinance is actually 10 feet. So,
what's 10 feet?
It's supposed to be the parking spot's supposed to be 10 feet away from the fire hydrant. It's 8 feet currently.
Okay.
So that is in a complex. This provide fire access and a bit more space to get to if we were 20 feet. That would be 15 feet then from the fire hydrant.
I believe our ordinance also is 20 feet from a crosswalk. We have loads of inconsistencies, as you can tell.
Just do my due diligence.
No, I appreciate that. No, and that's not a neurologic point, so thank you. Let's split these sides of the street in half if we can. Can we return to what I believe is the north side? The question of moving the bus stop on North Street from near State Street more towards the intersection of Masonic Street. Is there a motion to recommend that we move that bus stop?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Is there discussion on a recommendation to move that bus stop? And I assume that means replace the bus stop with parking spaces and remove the others.
Oh, right, that's just like that. Sorry,
before you make that. Go right ahead.
You would move the two parking spaces at the end to where the bus stop is currently. So you're swapping the bus with the parking spaces. My concern
that would be our proposal.
Right. My concern would be the queuing. I don't know if one vehicle length is enough for that right turn lane, because right now the bus stop is 56 feet plus that 25, but the bus is not always there, so you have space to get from the middle lane to that right turn lane. But if you have parking there, you can't get in there, and then it might queue in that center lane, possibly.
That's a good point.
Blocking more of that crosswalk across the street.
I guess this becomes our problem, because you don't particularly care if there's parking space.
We certainly can understand the balance the ordinance has to park.
Diplomatic. Or would you recommend that there be no parking spaces there, or one parking space? Or shall we make no recommendation and simply say, I mean, we'd be losing two parking spaces otherwise if we don't replace them.
Right.
It seems like, to me, honestly, and I bet you this is why they set it up this way in the first place, because they wanted to have more queuing there, because the bus is rarely there on that side.
Yeah, we have a bus there every 20 minutes. from the 43. The 98's there once an hour.
During full service, there's a bus there every 12 minutes.
But it stops only when there's a passenger getting on, and that's near the end of the line, so there's rarely
a passenger getting off. We have a number of passengers getting off that location.
So it's there momentarily. So anyway, my point is, I bet you that's why they put it that way, because they wanted the queuing to alleviate the other traffic problems here at this intersection. And so I think our engineer is making a good point, and we would want to just get an engineer's well thought out opinion on this.
No, Councilor?
I know that we're supposed to be separating these both sides of the street, but I think if we're talking about eliminating parking and we're talking about eliminating on both sides, we need to keep that in mind.
And I just reiterate for a second, you know, this, as I said from the get-go, this is a huge safety concern for PBTA. We've had accidents here, we've had vehicles hit buses trying to get back left, we're dropping people off into the street. It's not a safe location for a bus stop. So if we can't change this, we would request to eliminate the stop altogether and use the courthouse stop as the downtown stop.
Let's continue to pick this apart. Can we accept that this motion is purely to move the bus stop to where the two cars are at the intersection of Masonic Street, and we will not have this particular motion be a recommendation on replacing those where the bus stop currently is? Not that we won't do it, but that we're silent on that. We'll determine that later.
Sure.
So this motion is purely to recommend that we move the bus stop from one end of the block to the other, to the intersection of Masonic. Okay. Does that make sense? And we can tackle the question of parking. And I make the motion because I think the safety issue is important. Any discussion on that motion? All right, all in favor of that recommendation, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? All right. So we've recommended that you do move the bus stop on that side of the street. Now we're the other side of the street. We can return to that discussion. I mean, I'll just weigh in just briefly. It seems like if you're still gonna have queuing problems down South Street and there are substantial safety concerns, and we're weighing them, I err on the side of caution personally, and I would personally not take action on this one and not recommend it at this time. That's my personal view.
Yeah, I guess for me, to the extent it's unsafe, then maybe that distance would be greater than 20 feet you're proposing. But I get a bus is a lot bigger than a car. But if we're comfortable with the car being at 13 feet, I guess a bus at 20 feet is probably just as bad. So I would be, I think we should get rid of it. Maybe it's the same way of splitting up. I think we should get rid of the car. Where we should allow the bus, maybe it's a separate conversation. Maybe it's 24 feet. I don't have a number to give you, but I would certainly not have a car there.
So regardless of whether the bus stop is expanded, you're raising the subject of just eliminating that parking space.
Right.
Okay.
Well, frankly,
implicitly, that means we wouldn't expand the bus stop.
Well, at the very least, it would give them the ability to write the current stop line. Because the buses plot in the traffic, they can't right now pull up 1 inch from the rear curb, the rear bumper of the car. So it's still giving them a little more space. The area where they're allowed to go, they need their own safety.
Oh,
to
just for
traffic.
For pulling out.
I'm sorry, Ricky.
Okay.
That makes sense.
Ms. Forrest,
thank you.
I believe that by having that parking spot there, it protects the crosswalk. Because if a car is there, a bus cannot pull in there, cannot pull forward. And hash marks on the street, I don't believe, are going to stop that bus from pulling forward.
I would make sure that bus wouldn't pull forward. I mean, I have my manager operation here. I mean, if we have a bus stop and a line to stop at, we have excellent drivers here. We would not be violating any line that was given by the city of Northampton if. The bus, as Wayne illustrated, if the car's not there, we can pull forward and maximize more of that space instead of turning out from that space. But We certainly would not violate any line on purpose.
Yep, I think we appreciate that, and so thank you.
So there's a sign, there's a bus stop sign there now, and you would continue to use that post as your...
Absolutely.
Well, someone can make a motion on this, otherwise I would probably make a motion that we do not take action and leave things as they are.
I make a motion that we recommend eliminating that parking stop.
Second.
Okay.
Before we vote on that, I don't think we have any of these in the cities, but what about the option of having like a compact car spot or something? I hate to lose a whole parking space and the revenue associated with that, but it does seem to be that if there were a giant vehicle there, a van or a truck or whatever, it would be very hard to see around, but if it's a small car, it probably wouldn't be as much of an issue. Is that something that we've ever explored? I've never seen that space in the city where we really have a compact car. You would know.
There are two signs that say compact car parking only, but we don't have an ordinance to enforce that.
Do people respect the signs in any way? Absolutely not. All right.
There you go.
Okay.
Yeah, I sort of wish there was a middle ground as well. Just seems that on this very busy street at a crucial intersection, I don't know, I feel like lines painted on the ground, I'm sort of worried that people are not going to obey that. I'm worried they wouldn't obey a compact car symbol and that kind of thing. So
one of those,
I would argue for keeping it the way it is.
They're all small.
So you can charge a vehicle quickly for the bus.
They do obey that, don't they?
They do.
The charging station.
Because it's heavily enforced.
Yeah.
I also think that we just eliminated two parking spaces across the street, to Council Sherrill's point. I mean, right downtown. We just eliminated two parking spaces. Now we're going to eliminate a third one. So I think people are not going to like that when they're going to have reason not to like that, right at that crucial place. And then I think on top of that, you have the safety arguments that Ms. Forrest always making. So the combination of those two things, I'm personally not going to vote to, you know, to eliminate the third parking space today. But that's just my opinion. Any other discussion on this?
I have a comment about hiring. What is the measurement from the parking space to the hydrant? Is that
very?
Is it in compliance?
I believe the parking, according to our measurements, it was 8 feet from the end of the parking spot to the hydrant. And 5 feet set back from the ground.
It's supposed to be 9 feet. So that is out of.
And I believe the space is 21 feet, so.
Okay. All right, to the motion, which is to eliminate that parking space near the crosswalk. Any other further discussion? Okay. All right, well, let's just, I think this could be a divided vote, so can we do a roll call on this? And what that one means, we've never done this before, is this is the easiest way to do it. If our administrative assistant would just go down the list of the roster and call everyone's name, and then we'll say yay or nay, and then we'll record it that way.
This is whether or not we get rid of the space.
This is a motion to eliminate the space. Mm-hmm. So a yes vote will mean we eliminate the space.
Okay.
Okay.
I'm just going to use this sheet instead.
Oh, perfect.
It's okay.
I forgot you had it.
Jamie?
Yay.
Winfrey?
Yes. Yay.
Krista?
Nay.
No.
Motion fails, 5-2. Okay. So, thank you.
Thank you very much.
You got half of that.
I really appreciate it.
Thank you. We appreciate your time and all this great research. Thank you. All right. Last item we have, may not complete today, but it's a discussion on the road signs that we have in the city that warn of road work coming up ahead, and they say men working. And so the question is whether or not this sends the wrong signal to people, and whether we should replace by attrition or otherwise the signs that say men working with a more gender neutral option, workers ahead, or that kind of thing. So this is something that Councilor Sharon and I have actually talked about for a while. Some constituents of mine have brought it to my attention, other residents of the city, and just brought this up, and we wanted to put it on the agenda for discussion today about a possible recommendation, knowing we might need to gather more information. So.
Do we have this issue with men only from traffic control devices? That'd be my only issue. No. I'd be fine with it otherwise. If you're not sure
what? I'm sorry, what's
the manual, you know, from traffic control.
That
devices.
Signs would be non standard.
Sure.
Don't other communities have them in our Commonwealth? I've seen them differently. But that doesn't mean anyone's in compliance.
I believe there are options. I mean, we could also use a picture of like some of the
Yeah, we have several different signs that are currently in use. I think we have like mowing ahead and workers ahead, and we have the picture of the person shoveling. What I have asked is that we have an inventory taken of all of our signs, sort of department-wide, and I should have that by the end of this week. Replacement costs, they're sort of like roll up, you know, with a Velcro attaching mechanism, and then the stand is a separate piece. So if you can reuse the stands and just replace the signs, you'd be looking at far less money than actually replacing all the signs. I don't think we're looking at a huge expense here, but each sign is probably, you know, over $100 anyway.
Do we ever have all of our signs out in use, or could it be that we have more signs than we need?
We do have more signs than we have crews available, just due to the nature of the work. So it's something, you know, we could look to retire some of the old signs that might be more tired as we purchase new signs. We could you know, move in a gender neutral direction when we do that. You know, until I get a full inventory, I can't.
Great. Well, I appreciate that you're going to do an inventory. That'd be very helpful. Thank you. I want to make an informed decision and know about the money that the cost we would incur. So, any other comments on this subject? I mean, I think philosophically, like, I would guess we would be in agreement, but the details matter.
I will mention that other utilities, other contractors, you know, might have the men working signs out, so they're unaffiliated with us.
Right. That's an excellent point. So on that point, would it be possible to require, as a condition of contracting with the city, that they use certain signs? Just so, like, we're really annoying to work with.
So we can really stick it to people.
But actually, it's a serious question. So
at the very least, request that they use different signs.
Yeah. The city.
Preference.
I think present company is a testament to the fact that we as a city believe in that women in male dominated fields should be supported, and that it seems disrespectful to have signs being used that don't acknowledge our work. So.
Yeah. Okay. Great. Well, we'll follow up on this at a future meeting. Is there anything else in this item? Okay. Thank you very much. Any new business? If not, is there a motion? Are you just chewing?
Yeah, I'm
just chewing. Or maybe you're making a motion to adjourn.
Maybe to adjourn.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you.